All right, guys, welcome. We are back again for another day going over the laws of planetary motion, specifically Kepler. And we can see here that is included in our Go Blue. Just some updates, guys, for us. We will have our next test and notebook check coming up actually next week, particularly the middle and beginning of next week. So be on the lookout and be ready for that as we finish up with our moon phases at the end of this week. Number one, what does Kepler's second law state? Two, what does Kepler's third law state? And three, how long does it take for Neptune to orbit the sun? Let's go ahead and find out. Okay, number one, planet's orbit speeds up closer to the sun due to gravitational pull. So again, planets will speed up as they get closer to the sun because the gravity is stronger in those areas. For the second law of planetary motion, the greater the distance that the planet is from the sun, the longer the planet orbits. So for example, Earth will take 365 days, but because Mercury is shorter, it only takes 88 days. And to be specific, Neptune, the furthest planet in our solar system, is going to take 165 years. So a very long orbit because it is so far away. Kind of correlating with our third law, more distance, the longer the orbit. Again, guys, apologies if I sound different. I've got kind of some allergies. Okay, let's go ahead and go to our table of contents. And feel free to pause this video. This is pre-recorded as we go along. Add pages 8 through 9, spring and new tides. We are going to begin pages 6 and 7, Newton's laws of motion today. Again, we're going to begin pages 6 and 7, Newton's laws of motion today. Okay, our first question, blank is the first planet inside the asteroid belt while blank is the first planet outside the asteroid belt. Is it A, Mars, Jupiter, B, Mercury, Jupiter, C, Mercury, Saturn, or D, Jupiter, Mars? Not sure if I showed this already, but why not try it again? It's going to be, pause the video, letter A, Mars and Jupiter, Mars on the inside, Jupiter on the outside. All right, we have our first video question of the day, which is going to be, what is the difference between speed, velocity, and acceleration? Again, write this page down. Write this on page 7. I believe our Go Blue is on page 6. So, I do want this on page 7, which is going to be Newton's laws of motion. Newton's laws of motion is going to be the title. Again, write this down on page 7. I got to go. Let me just go ahead and kind of make this easier to read because I know it's in blue. It's harder to read, to copy down, right? Okay, let's go ahead and check out our video that has to do with that. Again, what difference between speed, velocity, and acceleration? I have a little football video I'm going to show that gives us some details on that.
From big and bulldozing to small and speedy, NFL running backs come in many shapes and sizes. But to succeed at football, all running backs must excel at kinematics, the branch of classical mechanics that defines how objects move.
Because kinematics describes motion, it describes everything an NFL running back does, basically,
all right,
which is...
And let's skip ahead and see the difference between our three terms, speed, velocity, and acceleration.
To help illustrate the concepts of kinematics, Deuce McAllister, all-time leading rusher for the New Orleans Saints, ran the 40-yard dash in front of a high-speed phantom camera.
You want to stay low as possible while running the 40, particularly the first 10 yards, so it's literally like you're being shot out of a cannon.
Using McAllister's personal best in the 40, 4.26 seconds, it's easy to calculate his speed. Divide the distance by the time to get his average speed, 9.39 yards per second, or 28.17 feet per second. To define the velocity, simply add a direction, 28.17 feet per second north.
when we talk about speed, we're talking about the magnitude of velocity. And then its direction is dictated by where the running back goes.
On the field, great speed is used to elude tacklers.
When you have speed and you have very good speed, that 5-yard play for most backs becomes a 50-yard play.
Also helpful is the ability to cut or suddenly change directions.
That helps you make moves against a defender. That helps you stay free from getting tackled.
Beyond position and velocity, the third kinematic concept is acceleration, which describes how fast speed is changing.
You never know when you may need to hit that button, you know, per se, to accelerate at maximum speed.
To understand acceleration, consider again McAllister's 40-yard dash. While his average speed is 28.17 feet per second, his instantaneous speed varies. He starts with zero speed and then increases his speed or accelerates until he reaches a top speed, let's say hypothetically 31.5 feet per second. If we know how long it takes McAllister to hit his top speed, let's assume 1.2 seconds, then it's possible to calculate his acceleration as the change in speed divided by the time.
Acceleration is the change in velocity per unit time, which if we compare it to velocity, was the change in distance per unit time.
In this case, 31.5 feet per second divided by 1.2 seconds.
So you can see acceleration, speed, velocity, all somewhat the same thing, but they have slight differences, right? So let's go ahead, go back to where we were at, check it out. So what are the specifics on that? Well, okay, first off, we've got speed, the rate at which an object changes position, right? Distance over time. So for example, car speed, they say miles per hour, right? So speed involves time. Speed involves time. So the rate at which you move at a certain amount of time. Velocity, now we're going to add direction. Same thing, just add north, south, east, or west. Speed amount in a specific direction. Acceleration is instead looking at the rate of change, right? So how long does it take to get to a certain speed? Or how quickly can you get to a certain speed? So rate at which an object's velocity changes. Okay, so make sure you got that down on page 7, Newton's laws of motion. All right, we're gonna go ahead and begin with first law on page 7. So again, you're gonna write this on page 7, guys, page 7. All right, first law, and again, if you guys were in person, I'd have you research this, but we're talking about force, okay? Not force, inertia. So for first law of motion, every object continues in a state of rest or a state of uniform motion in a straight line unless acted on by a force. So again, objects are going to resist change given their mass. That's inertia, okay? But again, objects want to go with momentum. If they're being pushed, they're going to get pushed. If nothing's acting, they're going to sit still. That's first law. Continues in a state of rest or uniform motion in a straight line that's acted on by force. Okay, so let's see a little example of that. For example, net force, right? So here's a little example of inertia. The water in the water balloon wants to stay in the shape of a water balloon until, even after being popped, until gravity acts on it and causes the water to slowly lose its balloon shape. This is inertia in action. This is a first law at play. First law, a good example of it, right? So we see even though it's popped, it's still retaining that balloon shape because of first law, inertia. Objects want to stay at a constant rate. We see that maintaining its shape for as long as it can because of inertia, right? Inertia. Okay, let's go ahead, move on to our next topic. We're going to skip net force a little bit, and let's talk about second law, and then we'll call it a day, guys. Second law. Okay, and I do want you to highlight, I want you guys to write these down, right? Just the formulas too. Okay, so when a force acts on an object, right? One second, let me pull it up on my screen here. So when a force F acts on an object with a mass, it produces an acceleration equal to the force divided by the mass. So just know the formula, guys. F equals mass times acceleration, or acceleration equals force divided by mass. So again, are objects speeding up or are they slowing down? Depends on the mass. That's all second law is saying. Depends on the mass. Okay. So sometimes if a light object can have a lot of force, it can go pretty fast. Heavy object, not a lot of force, go kind of slow. It takes longer to accelerate. Like a train. When a train starts, it's got a pedal, right? It takes a while, and then it's going to go. All right. So let's go ahead and check out our last video clip of the day. And check out this acceleration. We'll check out a cheetah versus a race car. Who's going to win? Who can accelerate faster? Let's see. Find out. Again, make sure, guys, you were writing all that stuff down on page 7. Make sure you got those first two laws down on page 7. Write down what's in red. Video again. Initially, the cheetah had greater acceleration, but in the end, the car caught up to it because of its engine power. So, depends on when the race stopped. You could debate who the winner was, but the race car looked like it won in the end. Let's do our last question. Let's check it out. So we did first and second law, right? One moment. Let me get the question up. Give me one moment, guys. All right, so we got to know Kepler's laws, right? So which of Kepler's laws discusses the idea that planets increase in orbital speed as they get closer to suns? They speed up as they get closer to sun. Is it first law, second, third, or fourth law? Got to know the number with what it does, what it shows. Pause the video, see what you think. Answer is going to be letter B, second law. This is Mr. Campbell. I will see you guys again tomorrow. We will finish Newton's laws tomorrow. Mr. Campbell, signing out.